Today's episode of the Bitcoin Show is brought to you by Mt. Gox, mtgox.com, and Bitcoin Bonus, bitcoinbonus.com, and Mezi Grill, mezegrill.com. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Bitcoin Show. This is episode 44, and we are back from Tokyo. We had an amazing week of shooting on-site in Tokyo, Japan. I wanted to surprise you guys. I know I gave you a little sneak preview via Skype because I thought I had fallen off the radar or something, but we got some amazing, amazing footage at Mt. Gox, at Memory Dealers, out on the town in Japan, and talking to the local Bitcoin community in Japan, and can't wait for you to see that. We're still editing it because we want to make it perfect, and probably the very next episode you see will be that, so stay tuned for our next episode. Today, though, we have a really special guest with us. His name is Matt Hutchins, and he is an attorney at law graduate of Harvard Law School. He is someone that we met actually at the Bitcoin Conference and World Expo in New York here. And we were talking about the Bitcoin Legal Think Tank. So our conversation actually began there at the conference. So welcome, Matt.
Thanks, Bruce. It's great to be on the show with you.
Sure. And you're living in New York now and getting ready to relocate to California?
That's right. I've been working in New York. I'm moving to Los Angeles. And I was really glad I had a chance to meet you at the conference and to speak with you and Gavin and all the other hotshots in the Bitcoin world. And it seems like there are a lot of fruitful discussions that are going forward on the basis of what was said at the conference.
Yeah, it's amazing, right? And, you know, I don't know, well, as I was telling you at the conference when we talked about this, I remember we met actually at Hudson Eatery the first
time. That's right.
Yeah, and I was sitting there and I was like, wait a minute, did somebody say he's a lawyer, an attorney? Wait a minute.
And then at the conference when I stood up and said I was a lawyer, I noticed people's ears perk up.
Ooh, a lawyer. Yes. We're looking for lawyers. Yeah, we're recruiting.
And then I definitely noticed that no one else said they were a lawyer. So.
Isn't that interesting, right?
Right.
So I had, you know, way back, you know, we went to meetup.com, which I recommend anyone who's interested in, you know, developing friendships and connections in the Bitcoin community, go to meetup.com. This is not a commercial, they're not a sponsor, but meetup.com is a great, great tool for networking. And so I went to meetup.com and created meetup.com/Bitcoin, which is the New York Bitcoin users group.
Yeah,
the first
meetup
one.
Is great.
It was a great thing. And actually, we'll talk about that tomorrow, but I had them do the same thing in Tokyo. So now there's one in Tokyo and Pittsburgh or Philadelphia, they're all over the place. So anyway, there's dozens of them now. But anyway, as a result of the meetup, this monthly meetup, we have these spin-off groups that have started and are emerging and kind of mutating. But the hackathon, which was a weekly thing going on for quite a while until all the developers got recruited and now they're all employed. So, you know, they don't volunteer as much
right.
when they're getting paid by multiple projects, it seems. And then the promote-a-thon, which is similar, you know, people just get real busy. But the other one was the Bitcoin Legal Think Tank, because I wanted to try and find attorneys who were really interested in all the various aspects. The legal implications of Bitcoin are at least as complex and fascinating, if you're into that sort of thing, as the technical aspects. But they're technical, they're both technical, but in very different realms.
That's
and
right.
Like one is extremely logical and the other one is extremely legal.
Well, the legal world requires its own logic.
Yeah, its own logic, right.
And I have the greatest admiration for Gavin and all of the technical development team. Those are some very skilled men. And when I met them at the... men is accurate because there really aren't that many women
That's
in the community
true.
Yet. But
That's true.
But they are... they're doing a great service to the entire... Really, the whole internet by developing this technology that we call Bitcoin.
Right.
But every new technology has implications that have to be sussed out on a legal side. And we're clearly already running into some of the issues that arise there. I wanted to come on the show to talk not about any particular application of the law to Bitcoin that you know, we might consider something like advice, mm-hmm. but more just to talk about why people should be looking for advice mm-hmm. and why people should talk to lawyers and think about these legal issues, not just from their own perspective, but from the perspective of, so not what's the self-serving answer, but what's the right answer, and mm-hmm. also what's the answer someone else might come to about this.
Right. It's difficult because this is one of the reasons why, I proposed this legal think tank. Oh, and by the way, the rest of the story about proposing this legal think tank was very fascinating because we didn't get a single attorney. I mean, what I did start to get, though, was I got contacted by law firms all mm-hmm. across the country and even the world outside of the U.S., who had been hired by startups or venture capitalists or whoever. They had been hired to research Bitcoin. So they start researching Bitcoin, and they somehow find out that I mentioned the word Bitcoin legal think tank, and then they contact me
right.
and say, we want to pick the brain of your legal think tank. And I'm like, well, guess what? You're it. You are it. There isn't one. You know.
Right.
So now we have Matt Hutchins, the legal think tank. But we'll talk more about that later. But we do want to cultivate at least some thought on these topics, because there's obviously a real shortage of knowledge. And I also understand that at least my understanding is that the way it's sort of working is we're looking at laws in it, if you forgive the analogy, the 1800s stagecoach transportation laws and trying to apply them to Star Trek teleportation that was just invented yesterday. And how does this fit when it comes to picking up horse dung on a public crosswalk? You know, it just mm-hmm. doesn't apply. So we're taking old laws and applying them to something brand new and revolutionary that's never existed before.
That's a fair way of characterizing the way that these sorts of things develop at first. Mm-hmm. In a certain sense, the way people should think about legal questions is the way that Sherlock Holmes would approach a mystery, which is, what are all of the possible solutions to this problem? And then, which one actually happened? eliminate all of the impossible ones and we'll find the correct answer. And with legal questions, we have to think about all the possible answers to a certain legal question mm-hmm. and think about the exact words that are used and think about how could these words be viewed by one person or another person and what are other ways that they might, the particular way that things are worded, how could that be important? And also, in an abstract sense, how does this feel? And what are the various perspectives people might have? And then, which one do I believe is correct? Mm-hmm. Which one serves my interests the best? Mm-hmm. And which one is most likely to be viewed by any particular third party, such as a regulator or a prosecutor? Mm-hmm. And those are people that we should be thinking about.
Right. And also, again, I'm a total layman. If I'm not mistaken, words have a common lingo, like street conversation out on the street, meaning, but then there's a legal definition that can be completely different. So mm-hmm. people can refer to Bitcoin as a virtual currency. Is it virtual? Is it currency? Okay, if you go to bitcoin.org and it says currency, therefore it's legally a currency. Well, no, I mean, the legal definition of currency mm-hmm. can be completely different. And it can be, if I'm not mistaken, it could be different, meaning state by state, country by country, and so on, right?
That's a good point. If you take, for example, the recent French decision that's generated so much interest in the Bitcoin community,
right.
One of the areas that was argued is whether or not Bitcoin is a currency. Because if it is considered a currency, then certain legal regimes apply. But if it's merely a form of property, which is intangible, mm-hmm. then different forms of legal regulation would apply. Now, that question is, first of all, it's hard to get a hold on exactly what elements of something make it a currency. There's mm-hmm. the question of whether it's a store of value that people can hold. And for example, I do work. I get paid in something, mm-hmm. I hold that and I use it to spend later. That's a store of value. People used precious metals like gold for that. You could use anything for that, really, as long as you feel that later on someone else is going to be interested in taking that from you.
Right.
Gold is commonly accepted as a store of value, but the actual use of gold is not that functional. Mm-hmm. You know, jewelry is attractive, but people are drawn to gold mostly because of the color and its mm-hmm. historical use.
I always point out that there are more retailers in Manhattan that accept Bitcoin readily than gold, perhaps.
Outside the Diamond District.
Outside the Diamond District, right. Unless they're actually, right. But I mean, for normal, ordinary commerce standing in line,
right.
Yeah, it's just not traded like that. And it's not divisible and convenient and so on.
Right. So in terms of a store of value, mm-hmm. we definitely see people using Bitcoin for that purpose. Mm-hmm. And in a lot of senses, it's better than gold because it is easier to transfer. Mm-hmm. It's potentially more secure because you could memorize a password to an encoded Bitcoin address, which is mm-hmm. stored in a secure place, mm-hmm. and then no one can get that mm-hmm. without having the password that only you know.
Right. Gold. Can't do that with gold. That's
right.
True.
Someone could deprive you of access to a secure file and keep you from getting your Bitcoin. But it would be hard for them to actually take possession of your Bitcoin that way.
You can also make, if it's an encrypted file, you can make mm-hmm. a million copies of it.
Sure.
And even then, it's pretty hard for them to deprive you of it if it's distributed all over the place, right?
Right. But then there are other aspects of a currency, such as its use in economic transactions. Mm-hmm. Bitcoin is being used for that some, but it's not really taken off. People are very optimistic about the Bitcoin economy, mm-hmm. and the infrastructure is still being put in place to make that possible.
Right.
And one of the most important aspects of a statutory definition of currency would be that it is a national currency. That
it's issued by someone.
Right, issued by anyone. So, for example, if we look at a country like, I guess, Bermuda has the Bermuda dollar. Now, the Bermuda dollar is one for one with the U.S. dollar. And so Bermuda is effectively on the international gold standard of the dollar, but they have their own currency.
Which is not really a gold standard, literally.
Well, sure, yeah, but the reserve standard that, you know, Bermuda knows that they have foreign currency reserves in mm-hmm. dollars, mm-hmm. And anybody in the whole world is going to take that.
Right.
And although, of course, you know, as people like to point out, the Federal Reserve could just print dollars. Yeah. Every time they've done that, they've taken them back out of circulation. And so it's been a very reliable central bank. Mm-hmm. And there's a good reason for that, in that there's a reputation to be held, as we've mm-hmm. seen lately, that could be put in danger. Mm-hmm. Bitcoin has certain attractive characteristics for a lot of these elements in terms of being a store of value, being transferable. It has not yet been used as a national currency, but it could be.
It could be, right?
It could be.
If a small nation like, was it Iceland or something, decides to make its national currency?
Maybe they would peg their currency to the Bitcoin. Maybe
they would. Without issuing it?
Well, they could simply abolish their own currency and say Bitcoin is now our national currency. Now, there's an interesting question. How would that affect the legal status of Bitcoin?
Wow.
So,
if it was complex enough already.
Yeah, right. An arbitrary action by some nation state that isn't within anyone's control, you know, could that suddenly change the legal status of Bitcoin?
Tanzania could do it. Anybody could do it. Any country could
do it. And it might even be a play by some, you know, actor in that country. Who knows? There could be reasons it might happen.
For the good or for the bad.
Yeah. So that's one reason that we have to look beyond the words mm-hmm. to what's actually happening.
Right.
One reason to think that Bitcoin could be considered a currency is that there are exchange markets. So functionally, it's being treated in the same way that a currency is treated.
Yeah, but the same is true for wheat and beans, and isn't it? Not everything with an exchange market is a currency.
True, but let's say I buy futures on wheat, which usually you would buy futures. Mm-hmm. Those are usually traded on a particular exchange, and it's a contract that's unique to that exchange. Let's say I actually buy the commodity itself. Then I have it and I have to sell it to someone in another place mm-hmm. people don't generally just give you money for the commodity. Mm-hmm. You have to find someone who's willing to buy it from you. And mm-hmm. so, sure, I could give, I could enter a contract that somebody else now owns my, you know, 100 tons of wheat, mm-hmm. and they accept delivery in the port of Long Beach in Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. And then it's their responsibility to ship it somewhere. But that's just the same thing as selling it to them. And I'm mm-hmm. probably going to take a hit on it because I'm not putting it in their hands. Mm-hmm. Bitcoin, on the other hand, all I have to do is just send it to them. And it's electronic, virtually zero transaction cost. Mm-hmm. So it's very fluid, it's fungible, it's divisible, and it is readily exchanged into currency all around the world. Let's say I had a large amount of Japanese yen and I wanted to change it into dollars. I could buy Bitcoin with my yen, I could send it to the US, and then buy dollars with my Bitcoin. So it acts as a medium between different currencies.
Yeah, a medium between currencies and a medium between geographic distances and national boundaries. It's so unique. So let me ask you this, because I'm confused. What are the basic legal definitions?
Don't feel bad about being confused, Bruce.
I know. It's very... I readily admit it.
Bitcoin's a confusing thing, and anyone who says they're not confused by it
is lying. No,
doesn't know enough.
Doesn't know enough, right? If they're not confused, then they should be.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So, let's start with this. What are the possible legal? Because we're talking about the legal definition of what is a Bitcoin or Bitcoins, the plural. It could be a You call it a statutory definition, okay? Right? Mm-hmm. Is that what you called it? So it could be a currency. It could be a store of value. Is there a long list of possible things that it could be defined as by any particular jurisdiction or regulatory body or prosecutor or whatever?
Well, some of those ideas were explored in the proposed paper, the draft paper that certain Yale student, law student, put on the Social Science Research Network, that paper got a good bit of attention. I disagree with some of his conclusions, but it illustrates that there are a lot of possible boxes in which Bitcoin might fit, and they're not necessarily mutually exclusive. On the one hand, you have the extreme of characterization of it as a security. I think that's a very dubious characterization. I think that securities generally have an issuer and represent a stake in some sort of a business. So
like a stock.
Yeah.
A stock is a security.
Bitcoin doesn't really resemble a stock at all. Yeah. You know, it's much more of a commodity, but you know, in the sense that it's more like owning a ton of coal that's sitting in a train car somewhere in the world, and that people can swap ownership rights to that, you know, object, mm-hmm. than it is that you, say, own 1/1000th of a percent in Microsoft, and mm-hmm. that the value of your stake in Microsoft is dependent on the value of the company. And necessarily on their future earnings.
Right. Yeah.
There are no future earnings in Bitcoin.
No.
That would be split up among stakeholders.
Right.
And so then there's the stored value question. That's certainly an attractive definition to slap on it, because it looks a lot like things that are stored value.
Let me ask you this. I'm sorry to interrupt. Mm-hmm. The stored value, is that what we would refer to as a gift card, like a Starbucks gift card?
That's what my understanding of stored value is.
Okay.
Now, I'm not an expert in that area, so... Mm. Clearly, we're just speculating here as to what any particular person might mm-hmm. think of Bitcoin.
Okay.
But Bitcoin is not a contract or any kind of amount which you could settle later. When I buy Bitcoin, I don't expect to have a claim on a particular fund. For example, a mm-hmm. gift card, technically, you're putting money into a fund that will sit there until you come back with your claim and mm-hmm. And take your part of that fund and usually transfer it to a designated merchant.
Right.
So one of the benefits, for example, of buying a Best Buy gift card mm-hmm. is that they might have the right to go ahead and book revenue on that amount because there's no right to a refund of your credit at Best Buy. And so merchants like that because...
Yeah, a lot of advantages for them.
Right.
You might lose the card too.
Yeah, but then you have a relationship with both Best Buy and the financial company that's holding the money.
Oh, it's not Best Buy? I always assumed it was the actual retailer. It
probably
depends
not.
On the case.
Probably not.
Probably not, yeah.
But with Bitcoin, you don't have a relationship with any particular person because you're holding the Bitcoin.
Yeah.
There's no one that...
There's no issuer.
You can't go to Gavin and say, hey, give me my money that I paid.
I tried that. It didn't work. He just laughed at me and hung up. Called Satoshi, too. Didn't work. So yeah, there's no issue. Again, there's no issuer. There's no fund. Right. There's no. It's just this. What do you call it? A intangible.
Yeah, it's sort of an electronic commodity.
Commodity. Yeah.
But even that, the closer you look at it, the more slippery Bitcoin is because you don't really attach yourself to Bitcoin. Owning a Bitcoin is really more a matter of having the power to transfer that Bitcoin to someone else.
Right.
Or
you don't, or you don't rather, actually possess the Bitcoin.
Right, since the person you
the
transfer it to will not possess it any more than you.
Right.
Then it's a matter of having the power to give someone else the power to designate another person who will have the power to hold it. And so it's right, it's a whole chain.
It sounds so funny when you say it like that, but it's true. That's
yeah,
exactly
it's
right.
It's the blockchain. And the blockchain is a matter of attaching one ID to a portion of a Bitcoin that was issued in the past, you know, some new entry on the blockchain, and there's only one person who has the authority to assign that block, you know, that little portion of the block, to the next person, who will then have the power to assign it to the next one.
And so
when we look at it, you really are the owner of your key.
Control. It's a key. You're not really holding
which
the
has
coin.
A
you're holding a key to the coin.
Yeah. You own your key in that you possess it and keep it secret. But then your key has a fluctuating value.
I've heard somewhere another possible definition is something to do with intellectual property. Mm-hmm. Is it intellectual property? And what would the other thing is, okay, if you call it a
currency.
It's open
source.
Yeah. Well, but I mean, the actual private key is not. That could be considered intellectual property that you own because it's your private key. I don't know. But, okay, the other thing is, okay, aside from the definitions, which I'm sure there are more, but, you know, a currency and a, you know, a commodity and all these different things, all the way to security to intellectual property, I want to let you continue discussing those. But the other thing is, what are the implications of that? For example, if... You know, if it were deemed by, and this is another thing, in completely different jurisdictions. Like in France, it might be considered this. In Ohio, it might be considered that. It's going to be a mess. But if it's deemed a security in Arkansas, there are existing laws that apply to security that suddenly apply to Bitcoin. Or if it's deemed to be intellectual property in Malaysia, there's going to be intellectual property law that suddenly, like that, applies to Bitcoin, right?
Right. So there are several different legal regimes that I'm sure a lot of people are concerned about. State money transmitter laws are right at the top. And that is a complicated area. I would certainly... So one of my favorite things to say is, I'm not your lawyer, but I can tell you that you should have one.
And I can recommend a lawyer.
I highly recommend people who are in my profession.
Yes.
Because we are hard to understand, and we have our own little language. It's called the law, and it's hard to understand in general.
Yeah.
But aside from state money transmitter laws, the Bank Secrecy Act is one of the big elephants in the room. And
is that the know your customer part, or is that just a part of it? Or
no,
not
as
all?
Far as I know your customer is
Patriot Act.
Yes, know your customer comes in with the Bank Secrecy Act, but there are other parts of the law that interface with the Bank Secrecy Act to create that.
Okay.
The key part of the Bank Secrecy Act, which creates that responsibility, is the need to register with FinCEN. And so what happens is The act itself creates the authority in various federal agencies, Federal Reserve is part of it, to promulgate regulations. The regulations are enforced by FinCEN. FinCEN is a supra-agency organization that connects with various government offices. Mm-hmm. And FinCEN requires reporting of certain transactions, including the anti-money laundering requirements. So Know Your Customer is like a subset of anti-money laundering. Mm-hmm. And anti-money laundering laws through the Bank Secrecy Act are certainly a problem for Bitcoin, in that if you are subject to the Bank Secrecy Act, you need to be collecting that information from your customers. Now, how do you get there? Currency exchangers could be subject to the Bank Secrecy Act. That's one possible way of getting there. But the statutory definition of currency, as far as I remember, or the regulatory definition, mm-hmm. goes back to this concept of national currency. Mm-hmm.
So you have to be, when you say currency exchangers, you mean one currency for another currency? Because if I'm selling baseball cards, that's not a currency exchanger. I'm selling baseball cards for dollars. Baseball cards are not a currency. But currency for currency.
But FinCEN regulates dealers in gold in the same way that they would regulate a currency exchanger. They might look at what you're doing and say what you're doing is similar enough that you need to be a member of the FinCEN mm-hmm. network. You need to be mm-hmm. registered with us, and you need to be reporting certain types of transactions mm-hmm. And complying with any money laundering laws.
There's the rub. It sounds arbitrary. Right. Like they just decide this. That's the problem with these things. I say there should be an agency that you could go to with a proposed business plan mm-hmm. and get them to advise you to say this is legal or this is not legal.
When people that's the role of lawyers in our system. That's the role of mm-hmm. lawyers in that.
But they won't guarantee anything is legal. Right. They'll guarantee certain things are illegal, but they won't guarantee anything is legal, mm-hmm. right?
Well, that resembles what's happening with this French decision, because the French court, going all the way back to where we started, mm-hmm. Said that, as far as I could tell, my French is a little rusty, said that the bank which closed that account acted improperly. Mm-hmm. But it didn't decide the underlying issue of whether Bitcoin is a currency or whether it is an electronic or some sort of electronic asset. It doesn't mm-hmm. seem to have definitively decided that. That yeah. seems to still be an open question that could be reversed. It was more, I think, and you know, I'm not trying to give anyone advice on this, but just right. saying that they appear to have made their ruling more on the rights of an account holder, and yeah. saying that it was their right to have time and notice. And that's certainly one avenue that you can use to defend your own rights whenever they're implicated by a relationship like with a bank, mm-hmm. is you can say, maybe you disagree with me about this, but we should take this question in front of a court, mm-hmm. and you should give me an opportunity to defend myself before you do anything which might affect my business.
Exactly.
That's a good time to have a lawyer.
Yeah.
But and it's good to have a lawyer say that to them, because lawyers also know how to communicate with business people in a way that is less, I won't say less adversarial, but maybe less confrontational or at least less emotional.
They speak the same language.
Yeah. Yeah. Maybe less emotional.
Yeah.
And saying
less prone to misunderstanding, I guess.
Right. Right. Just saying we have rights.
Yeah.
You can't stomp all over them. So going back to where we were saying about the Bank Secrecy Act, one of the ways that you get stuck in the Bank Secrecy Act could be if Bitcoin is a currency. There's another issue that comes up, though. So we mentioned state money transmitter laws. Mm-hmm. If you look at, one of the important legal decisions or legal cases that involved electronic currencies is, of course, the E-Gold case. Mm-hmm. And E-Gold was prosecuted under the Patriot Act for not being a registered money transmitter right. when they should have been.
Right.
And so that's part of
That was state money transmitter
law. Right, so state money transmitter law could be the basis of a federal prosecution under the Patriot Act.
Mm-hmm.
And the Patriot Act looks to many different sources of law.
Mm-hmm.
State law is one of them. The Bank Secrecy Act is part of that. The Patriot Act also can cause you to be subject to the Bank Secrecy Act
mm-hmm.
if part of your business is related to an informal value transfer system,
mm-hmm.
IVTS. So informal value transfer system mm-hmm. is traditionally associated with a hawala or a black market peso system.
Mm-hmm.
And there is an argument to be made that Bitcoin is a perfect incarnation of that.
Like an electronic ledger that's...
Right.
Does it need to be centralized or to be defined as that? Maybe
well,
not.
Well, and see, that's the thing, is there are ways to distinguish it.
Mm-hmm.
I would argue that Bitcoin is not an IVTS
mm-hmm.
in the traditional sense,
mm-hmm.
but the words informal value transfer system, mm-hmm. you know, they have this sort of vague and menacing sound to them, you know, like, what the hell is that?
And rare baseball cards could be called that.
Right, yeah.
Anything could be called that.
Right. And so mm-hmm. that's exactly the point. If yeah. anything can be called yeah. an informal value transfer system, then somebody might try to use it to call it that.
Makes sense.
And so it comes back to, do you really want to take a chance? And shouldn't you be thinking about avoiding the wrath of a prosecutor instead of trying to placate one who is already angry at you?
Exactly. Obviously, you know, I was in Tokyo recently, and I was sitting right there next to Mark when he got the call from the lawyers in France, in Paris, and I want to tell you how he explained it to me. So, but first, right, so stay tuned right after this, because I want to thank our sponsors, and if it weren't for them, including Mark, Mt. Gox, obviously, Mt. Gox is the largest and oldest Bitcoin exchange site. If you want to buy or sell Bitcoin without leaving your easy chair, just get on your laptop and type in mtgox.com, mtgox.com. They also now have a new site called Bitcoins with an S, bitcoins.com, which is in development. It's like in beta at this point, but it's going to be the new portal site for Bitcoin beginners. People who don't know anything about Bitcoin, they can go there and learn about Bitcoin and get set up. They can actually buy Bitcoin and they don't have to even worry about the dollars. It immediately, whatever they buy, immediately turns into Bitcoin. So it's a real slick new service for Bitcoin beginners. But for traders and advanced functionality, it's still Mt. Gox, mtgox.com. Like I say, they have the vast majority market share. They're in it for the long haul, and they have two-factor authentication, which means you get a little USB device that's really affordable, and it's a little tiny thing that fits on your key ring, kind of like one of those little drugstore barcode things. It's really tiny. It was so thin I thought it was a printed image on the actual paper when I got it, but it peels right off. But it goes on your key ring, you stick it in the USB port, and it actually types in a unique password that's only good for 1 second. So your computer could be full of viruses, and it doesn't matter. The virus can't capture the wallet file because your Bitcoins are on Mt. Gox, and the virus can't capture the password because it's only good for one. It can capture the password, but it's only good for 1 second, so it's useless to the thing. So that is a brilliant advancement in security. And we thank Mt. Gox for all of their support of the Bitcoin Show, bringing us to you every day. And BitcoinBonus.com. Bitcoin Bonus is a real cool service that we actually discovered way before they became a sponsor. They contacted us and decided to become a sponsor. But I had already been hearing about it from people who buy things online on a regular basis. You can buy from Dr. Frugal here shops online at Best Buy and all the major buy.com and all the major online retailers are there, including web hosting. I heard from a web designer who sets up hosting accounts for his clients several times a week, and every time he sets up a hosting account, he gets this big booty of Bitcoin. So it pays you back in Bitcoin for shopping online, doing the shopping that you're doing anyway. The trick is you got to remember. So whenever you're about to check out, whenever you're about to click that checkout button, go, wait a minute, let's pop over to bitcoinbonus.com and see if they're on there. And they probably are, chances are, because he's adding new vendors all the time. And you just click the link through that, and you're going to get kickback in Bitcoin. So we thank BitcoinBonus.com for sponsoring the Bitcoin Show. And Mezzi Grill, of course. Everybody knows Mezzi Grill is so famous, not only for being the world's first restaurant that brick-and-mortar restaurant, if there's any other kind, that accepts Bitcoin. They also sell Bitcoin. And they're open 7 days a week, breakfast, lunch, and dinner, where authentic Mediterranean food meets modern flavor. It's delicious. That's the bottom line. It's very, very healthy and delicious. So if you're in New York or you're passing through New York, ask anybody, where's Columbus Circle? And then it's 3 blocks south of that. That's a tourist destination. Anyway, everybody goes to Columbus Circle. You'll see the site at the southwest corner of Central Park where all the films are made, and you'll recognize all those scenes. Just walk a couple blocks south, and right there on the left, Mezzi Grill, MEZEGrill.com. And we thank Marwan at Mezzi Grill for sponsoring the Bitcoin Show. All right, so we're back. Now, I want to tell you, this is about the French case. I was so cool because after hours, I got really some really good quality time in there with Mark, because you know everybody went home for the night in the evening, and Mark's sitting there, the hacker that he is, you know, hacking away. And I would sit right next to him and ask him questions and try not to bother him, but you know, pay attention to what he was doing and learn. Really cool. At one point, I'm trying to think, it would, I can't remember if it was in the morning or at night, but anyway, the phone rang, and the phone on the desk rang, and he goes, "That's France." So he knew that was Paris calling, and so that's the decision. Because he told me, like 5 minutes before, he said, like, "They're going to be calling any minute. This is the outcome of the latest outcome, I guess." It's a continuing saga, because they closed his account, and then they were ordered to open it again. They opened it, I think, and then they closed it again, and you know, just back and forth, this continuing thing. From what I understand, like, he's really pursuing this primarily, at least one of the main reasons is because he's hoping that this will set a precedent that, you know, they'll be able to use, hopefully, in the rest of Europe and other places, that it'll set some case law, because that's what is needed, case law.
That's a valid point. I think that he's, you know, to be commended for going to court over it and not just backing out and
going away
around,
like they would like him to, yeah.
Right. And really, in order to defend your rights, you have to act quickly. Because if you let it get stale, then sometimes it can be hard to get back in the position you were in before. Now, in the US, I'm sure that people will be fighting the same fights. The French case will not really set a precedent in the US.
Right.
So as much work as is done there, it'll all have to be done over and over again.
Yeah.
So that's one wasteful aspect.
There'll be
of the
early
legal
martyrs
system.
Too, like the early pioneers. You know, many of the early pioneers died. Sadly, you know,
the Oregon Trail.
Oh yeah. Oh, what I wanted to say though, this is, I'm sorry to interrupt, but I wanted to get this part out. Is that he? This is one of the things that he told me was, the way he explained it to me was that, you know, it was a battle about closing our account and or leaving it open, their account, that is. And that in French law, if a small business or any business needs a bank account to survive as a business, which they do, obviously, for the operation of their business, they are required to be allowed to have a bank account in France. So that's what this is based on. Now, so there's opening and the closing, and the bank, flying in the face of the judges, the court's ruling, and being fined per day until they open it, and so on, opening it, closing it again, and so on. But the other thing was that the way he explained it to me was that the court had declared that no, you bank, you are not the authority on deciding what Bitcoin is, and it is not up to you to decide what Bitcoin is. That it's up to this other court or agency or whatever. So now I think that's been kicked over, and now they finally have said that this other court needs to decide. So I think that it's actually spinning off another case.
This is something which is potentially a unique feature of French law, in that the banking system is regulated in a way in which these sorts of decisions are appealable to a government body.
Yeah.
So that's one advantage that they're enjoying right now.
Right.
Another thing which potentially applies here, I don't know anything about the French code itself, but there is a European electronic money directive which could color the interpretation of things. One of the aspects of the The ruling, which I noticed, mm-hmm. is that the French court said that there's no counterparty in this transaction, and so that cuts against it being considered a form of electronic money.
Is that the same thing as saying mm-hmm. there's no issuing entity?
Right.
Okay.
Right. Mm-hmm. And so the European e-money directive makes it easier for an issuer to enter the business of creating an electronic currency mm-hmm. that would, you know, essentially possess a lot of the aspects of Bitcoin, mm-hmm. But maybe resemble more like e-gold. Mm-hmm. And in theory, someone could use Bitcoin for that purpose. They could take the technology of Bitcoin, mm-hmm. create their own blockchain, issue it out, and do it one for one with whatever currency they want, mm-hmm. And just amass a fund of money that they hold in a bank account that people can come back and claim against. Mm-hmm. But it would be unlikely that people would be doing that, because if they know that the electronic currency is as good as that currency, then they'll be happy to hold the electronic currency.
Right.
And so in theory, they would be putting more and more of that electronic currency into circulation, mm-hmm. and it would function out there just as money.
Right.
So the Europeans are already ahead of the game on that. They're thinking in the future. They're thinking, what's the next step for personal finance, which is probably what that would be used for. In America, we don't have anything like that. In fact, our laws are very draconian in that area.
I think I might have missed something in your explanation. This electronic money directive, is that what
you're talking about? That's a European Union level regulation.
And it's a regulation. And what is that regulation? It just defines what electronic money is?
So it's difficult for me to say. I can't tell you that that's binding law in the entire European Union. It may be that sets a standard that mm-hmm. countries have to adopt. But as far as I know, it creates a procedure, a set of guidelines, and defines a certain type of activity, which is known in Europe as electronic money.
So it's a directive, and it sets a procedure and so on. But it's not necessarily law that's binding.
Oh, that's it. So
it's
not
confusing.
Not all law is binding in the same way.
Okay.
Law is a universe of different interacting regimes, mm-hmm. and although there might be one form of law which applies in some circumstances, there could be other forms of law that would preempt it. So mm-hmm. it may be that a European nation could individually enact a law which says that we don't honor this certain directive, or they could refuse to enact it locally. So it's very complicated. Just like the U.S. has state law and mm-hmm. federal law, you know, I can't tell you whether that would be binding everywhere. Mm-hmm. But just the existence of that regulation mm-hmm. Would be likely to influence the definition of electronic money mm-hmm. and currency
in these member nations.
But mm-hmm. Courts are dynamic. One of the reasons we have courts is that it would be easy to avoid the law if there were not a human being interpreting it. Mm-hmm. In that, you know, if everything was just defined in a code, in a book, and you could just look and see what is subject to a certain law and mm-hmm. just those words applied, then you could just walk right around it.
Yeah.
And so it's not that easy. If it is Mt. Gox that is involved in this fight in France, they might have a long and difficult fight ahead of them, mm-hmm. and that can be very expensive. Mm-hmm. Mt. Gox is uniquely situated to bear a financial burden mm-hmm. in the Bitcoin community, mm-hmm. in that they have the highest transaction volume and they are mm-hmm. Drawing a certain percentage of those into their own funds.
Yeah.
But some of the smaller Bitcoin shops would not be able to afford the kind of legal fight that would be needed in order to get a judge to decide these kinds of questions,
right,
and to survive the appeals.
It's important that a judge decides these questions in one way or the other. Just, you know, whether it's good or bad per se, of course, good or bad just depends on your viewpoint, but either way, it's good that it's decided so that people have some basis to make decisions on. Like, they know case law, basically, that okay, this has been ruled on before, so we can assume that this is the way it would be ruled on again, right?
The thing about case law is that it's very much rooted in the facts. So on the one hand, that means that you may not be able to rely on one case when your facts are different. Mm. Another thing is that case law doesn't emerge until the facts are there. So, and a case doesn't just spring out of the blue. Mm-hmm. Cases are brought by parties for a reason. Mm-hmm. So, in the case of this French dispute, it's mm-hmm. entirely possible that the bank would just say, enough, we don't want to fight you, that's it. And then they withdraw all of whatever has happened, mm-hmm. and there might not be any binding law mm-hmm. that comes out of all this. Mm-hmm. And that's often what happens in these areas, is that rather than litigate something to a binding opinion, especially large corporations will often avoid that and enter settlements. Mm-hmm. In this case, it would just be not fighting anymore.
So it could be a while before something actually ends up being decided mm-hmm. as case law. And then, like you said, if the facts are the facts are different in every case.
And even if the facts are exactly the same, if you're in different parts of the federal system, then the court could disagree with other courts that have ruled on the issue. And it wouldn't be ultimately decided till it reached the Supreme Court, which it might never get there. And so you might never have the kind of definition that you would want. This is one area of the law where, or one reason that the law can create uncertainty right. that will limit the potential for investment in new mm-hmm. technologies.
Big investors are very hesitant to get into something that's a legal gray area.
That's exactly right. And often they would rather develop their own competing technology that they can predict and which they can run under their own organizational umbrella mm-hmm. Because it's more controllable. Mm-hmm. They can defend it as part of their existing operations, a new product. Mm-hmm. Or it may be that they feel like something like Bitcoin, it's just too out there, too international, and too dangerous.
Too uncontrollable.
Right. Right.
I imagine a big company like Microsoft or Google or Apple mm-hmm. would want total control of whatever it is they do, because mm-hmm. especially if they put their name on it.
Mm-hmm. And for the same reasons that the Bitcoin community has a communal nexus effect where people's work gets shared and everyone builds on everyone else's work, mm-hmm. there's a free rider problem, which mm-hmm. Is potentially implicated in legal fights in that. Let's say I invest $10 million in setting up my big business, mm-hmm. and then I spend another $10 million on litigating and defending my rights against Visa and Bank of America and PayPal, and I win all those fights. Mm-hmm. And then what's going to happen the next day? Somebody else is going to come along and spend $100 million and build a Bitcoin business that's 10 times as good as mine. So. Yeah, that's something to worry about too.
Mm-hmm. Wow, it's a wild spectrum. So, where does this leave us? This quite. Oh, by the way, before we get back to that, I want to bring this up that you are willing to and interested in. I kind of recruited you, I know, but for this Bitcoin legal think tank, because you seem to be the first lawyer who has actually expressed an interest in exploring all these things, besides just contacting me to be to ask the think tank questions. So I want to appeal again, if you're watching this video and you are an attorney anywhere in the world, right? It doesn't have to be the United States, because this applies to it's a global currency. You can actually reach Matt at what is it? BitcoinLegalThinkTank@gmail.com. You got it in there? So
that's
see right there, BitcoinLegalThinkTank@gmail.com. Send Matt an email and you're starting a mailing list, and you'll be able to discuss some of these things in an interesting way, which is really, really needed. And then I'll have some place to send these calls that I get from these big, big law firms. They don't know where to begin. They don't know who to talk to.
Well, the stage that we're at right now is that there needs to be a conversation among people who have differing views. Mm-hmm. And through that dialogue that emerges, there will be positions staked out, and a landscape will emerge. Mm-hmm. And then we can, as a community, start to form a sense of where Bitcoin stands mm-hmm. and create a self-governance mechanism mm-hmm. in which individual businesses either get certified by some sort of group that looks at the way that they're behaving, mm-hmm. or more likely, they would adopt the principles of a community document, sort of like the Creative Commons is out there as a document, mm-hmm. which is then used by individuals to give certain rights away to their work. Mm-hmm. If we have a community document out there on Bitcoin,
like a wiki, like a legal wiki or something.
Well, it could be that there would need to be an organization involved, and there are various organizations that operate in the electronic sphere. Mm-hmm. So it'd be good if there could be some imprimatur put on it. Mm-hmm. But maybe the first stage would be just having a white paper developed in the community, mm-hmm. and then moving on to a set of self-governance principles, mm-hmm. And then from there, possibly creating a certification system, mm-hmm. And ultimately the goal of all that would be to get ahead of the regulatory game. Mm-hmm. So by defining the nature of Bitcoin, mm-hmm. and creating principles that everyone accords with, mm-hmm. You can influence the view of Bitcoin that will be taken at a later time.
Right.
And the community needs to actively be engaging in the dialogue that's necessary to explore the law, to examine the nature of Bitcoin and the way that it is being used, mm-hmm. and to make decisions about, in a forward-looking way, about what should be done and what should not be done. Mm-hmm. And there should be some mechanism of identifying those who are actually following certain principles and those who are not, mm-hmm. But that's very difficult. And so that might not come until a later time down the road, mm-hmm. but at least there need to be some guiding principles.
Yeah, because like right now, I mean, until these issues are decided about what is Bitcoin, I mean, the basic ideas, if somebody, whatever, in name a state, Missouri, decides he wants to, whatever, he's a college student in Missouri and he wants to start his own Bitcoin exchange site. Now the software is free, open source. Anybody can be a bank. Scary. But anybody can open up an exchange site, for example. What kind of guidance can that person get? Because it depends on, the are we defining it as a currency? Are we defining it as, this or that? You know what I mean? Like, they're just really operating in the dark. And even if they hire, the best law firm in their town, they mm-hmm. They're going to be calling you. It's kind of like the blind leading the blind at this point, isn't it?
I would say, in a lot of ways it is. And, I may have read some of these statutes and looked at some of these questions, but I know nothing about compliance with the Bank Secrecy Act, and that's what it comes down to, is do you or don't you? And registration with the state regulators as, say, a money transmitter, mm-hmm. Do you or don't you? And mm-hmm. I think those are questions that have to be answered on a case-by-case basis by individuals who are looking at their personal risks and considering what sort of liability they could face, mm-hmm. and exactly what they're doing. So mm-hmm. there are some ways in which you might structure your business carefully under the advice of an attorney, mm-hmm. so that you could make it clear to regulators mm-hmm. that you are not a money transmitter. Mm-hmm. But you might speak with a lawyer who would say, still, all the same, you should think about the real risk that you're taking. And mm-hmm. look at eGold. That was a very serious prosecution. Mm-hmm. Nobody wants to be indicted for a federal offense. Because mm-hmm. even an indictment, even if you do not ultimately have any guilt in the matter, mm-hmm. even if you successfully defend yourself, mm-hmm. an indictment itself is very damaging. Mm-hmm. And I would, anyone who disagrees with my ideas about talking to a lawyer and going to regulators, I strongly encourage them to read Harvey Silverglate's book, Three Felonies a Day. It is a case-based analysis of what federal prosecutors can do when they get a bug up their ass. and I think that Harvey Silverglate
has written
a lot about this. Yeah.
Weren't you talking about that at Hudson Eatery when we were sitting outside? And
maybe I was. Yes, maybe I was. So.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So three felonies a day. Wow. Pick it up, look at it, and think about it mm-hmm. before you decide not to talk to a lawyer.
Yes.
It's cheaper to read a book than to talk to a lawyer.
Yes, but probably one is a good prerequisite to the other so that you have an understanding of how important it is. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's just kind of mind-boggling, but it's a real, I call it, a city full of warehouses full of mm-hmm. Cases of cans of worms. It's just a huge complex. And we're almost out of time, but I want to ask you this. Like, when you talk about state banking regulations, mm-hmm. just generally speaking, I know this is not specific, but in general, are they very similar from state to state, or are they completely different state to state?
They can be totally different. Some of them are based on a model law or here or there, but they can be totally different and deviate in unpredictable ways.
So if you're doing anything that covers even just the whole country of the United States, you have to deal with these regulations in every single state that you deal with.
Until we have a federal law that covers exactly this area, mm-hmm. then there will not be any preemption, and there is a crazy quilt of state law.
Wow.
That's the term sometimes.
Crazy seen. Quilt.
Yeah.
Very apropos.
Yeah. I would just say this, that Bitcoin is very exciting, mm-hmm. And the people who are using it are doing, I think, really good things with it, in that they're thinking about how to make transactions easier for individuals. Mm-hmm. In and of itself, Bitcoin seems to be legal to use and to hold, and you know, it's something that's out there on the internet. It's a technology, mm-hmm. but the key choke point is going to be the exchanges and the places where cash meets Bitcoin. And that's,
what about individual people, like junior high kids who have iPhones, and they say, here's $5 worth of Bitcoin. I mean, they're doing the same thing, where the cash meets the Bitcoin. Is that, I mean, it's a tiny scale, maybe no one's ever going to pay attention.
Doing anything as a business can get you in trouble. But if you mm-hmm. do it on a really small scale, then, the law is generally more favorable to you. And it also becomes a question of whether anyone would waste their time with you.
Right.
But if you're handling large amounts of money and you think you might have customers that have rights against you, mm-hmm. then you should definitely have a lawyer.
Yeah, that's for sure. Okay, well, on that note, I want to thank you, Matt, especially for stepping up and kind of, in a way, you know, you're a leader now, because you're the first founding organizer of the Bitcoin legal think tank,
trailblazer, pioneer.
Everybody who's discussing this now is a pioneer, because this is mm-hmm. such a new thing, and it's really cool to be on the cutting edge of whatever it is, mm-hmm. whether it's good or bad, it depends on your perspective and all that stuff, but it's mm-hmm. really fascinating no matter how you look at it.
Well, so. I like to think of myself as a Bitcoin wildcat out there prospecting the legal terrain.
There you go. Cool. So if you're a legal wildcat, definitely send an email to bitcoinlegalthinktank@gmail.com, and also give us your feedback here on the Bitcoin Show anytime. We love to hear from you. bitcoin@onlyonetv.com, all spelled out. And thank you, Matt Hutchins, for joining us today. Really appreciate
Thanks, Bruce.
It. It was great.
It was great.
All right. Take care. See you all. Same time tomorrow. Thank you.